वो लाइव करो, स्टार्ट रिकॉर्डिंग स्टार्ट होगी ना, बस इधर वो लाइव कर रहा हूँ, कुछ नहीं करना ना।
वेल फ्रेंड्स, आई वेलकम यू ऑल ऑन द टॉपिक अकाउंटिंग स्टैंडर्ड्स एंड प्रिंसिपल। वेल फ्रेंड्स, दिस टॉपिक वी हैव टेकन अप फॉर द स्टूडेंट्स ऑफ आर बीकॉम प्रोग्राम, एमकॉम प्रोग्राम एंड एमसीए प्रोग्राम ऑफ इंदिरा गांधी नेशनल ओपन यूनिवर्सिटी। वेल फ्रेंड्स, today this topic is very very relevant in the present business environment. When we talk about accounting standards, so accounting standards are nothing but are the sets of rules and guidelines that are followed in order to record the business transactions in the books of accounts and for the preparation of financial statements. So well friends, you know that this is the era of globalization, and the globalization has made the accounting informations very important. Therefore the diverse accounting policies being followed world over has made the accounting information a less important and incomparable. Therefore the necessity was felt that there must be certain minimum standards that must be followed world over uniformly in order to standardize the accounting procedure and to make the financial statements comparable. Therefore the International Accounting Standards Committee was set up for this purpose in 1973. So ICAI, that is Institute of Chartered Accountants of India, and ICWAI, Institute of Cost and Works Accountants of India, both are the members of this committee. So earlier these accounting standards were recommendatory, but later on all the accounting standards were made mandatory for the firm, because when we talk about the globalization, so when the whole world is one market, therefore there must be such accounting policies and practices which must be followed universally to make the accounting practices standardized and to make the accounting informations more relevant, and there must be a uniformity in a recording of business transactions in the books of the accounts, and there must be, you know, comparability among the financial statements. Well friends, because when there is no uniformity either in the recording of the business transactions or in the preparation of financial statements, under such a situation financial statements prepared over a period of time cannot be compared. So therefore the accounting standards provide you the framework where the accounting policies or accounting practices are followed by the firms uniformly to bring uniformity and to make the financial statements comparable, to make the financial statements more understandable, more reliable, and to ensure the transparency in the preparation of the financial statements. Because the users, there are many stakeholders who have vested their interest in a particular business. So until or unless that particular business follow the uniform accounting policies which are being followed world over, the importance and the relevance of such accounting statements are less. Therefore, the accounting standards provide you the framework where the financial statements are prepared uniformly, and as a result, they can be compared. Well, friends, there are certain objectives of accounting standards. The first one, as we have already discussed, that it brings uniformity in recording the business transaction as well as in the preparation of the financial statements. Then second one is to ensure transparency, consistency and comparability. So, well, friends, as we have discussed, that when the business transactions are recorded uniformly and the accounting statements are prepared on the basis of uniform accounting policies, they can be compared easily and they can be followed consistently. Because when we do not follow the accounting practices or accounting policies consistently, then again the uniformity cannot take place. So these accounting practices and accounting policies must be followed consistently over a period of time to ensure the uniformity in the recording of the business transactions and in the preparation of the financial statements. Then to enhance the reliability of the financial statements. Well, friends, so here we have used certain terminologies that accounting standards are basically a set of rules and guidelines, that is GAAP, generally accepted accounting principles. So when we follow the uniform accounting policies in order to record the business transaction in the books of the accounts and in order to prepare the financial statements, then of course it brings reliability. So when the financial statements are reliable, it enhances the confidence of the investor, it enhances the confidence of the debtors, creditors, bankers, governments, and there are many stakeholders who have vested their interest in that particular business. Then to minimize the diverse accounting policies. So, well, friends, this is, we have already discussed that the main objective of accounting standards is to minimize the diverse accounting policies, because when one country is following some accounting policies in order to record the business transaction and in order to prepare the financial statements, and on the other hand, the other country is following different accounting policies in order to record business transactions and to prepare the financial statements, under such a circumstances, the financial statements prepared by both the firm in different countries cannot be compared and it cannot be reliable, because the accounting informations do not provide uniform accounting informations, and as a result, the investors cannot have any sort of reliability on the recording of the business transactions and on preparation of the financial statements. Then advantages. Well, friends, the first one is create confidence among users of accounting informations. So, well, friends, I have already mentioned that there may be many users of accounting informations. The persons who have extended the credit facilities to the firm, or the supplier who has sold the goods to us on credit basis, they are also interested to know the accounting informations about our business. So it creates confidence. So when our accounting transactions are recorded in a uniform way and based on the accounting standards, then of course anybody who have vested their interest, they can easily extend the facilities to the firm. Then it helps the auditor while auditing the accounts of that particular firm. So when the auditor is sure that the firm has entered all the business transactions keeping in view the accounting standards and the preparation of the financial statements is entirely based on the accounting practices and accounting policies which have been guided by the accounting standards. So it helps the auditors. So it is the work of the auditor to audit the accounts of that particular firm. Limitations. So well friends, the first one is accounting standards are man-made. So when these accounting standards have been issued by a committee where the persons from different organizations are there, so there may be a chance of personal biasness. So anybody who is closely associated with a particular nature of the firm, so he may be biased to some extent. So therefore, these accounting standards which have been issued by the accounting standards committee, or in India accounting standards have been issued by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India. So whenever the involvement of any individual takes place, there may be a chances of personal biasness. Then accounting standards are based on business environment and law prevailing in the country. So well friends, accounting standards are flexible in nature. These are not rigid in nature, because accounting standards are entirely based on the business environment and laws. So accounting, this business environment and laws generally tends to get changed over a period of time. So when the business environment and when the law are being changed, then definitely the accounting standards need to get changed. Well friends, accounting principles, practices, concepts, conventions, generally we call it GAAP, generally accepted accounting principles. So the very purpose of the GAAP, that is principles, accounting concepts, is that the accounting informations must be recorded in a uniform way, because it brings uniformity in the preparation of the financial statements and it brings reliabilities in the mind of the investors or in the mind of the various stakeholders who have vested their interest. So ICAI issues the accounting standards to standardize the accounting practices, to bring uniformity so that the financial statements are compared. So well friends, these accounting principles have been categorized in two categories. The first one is accounting concepts. So these accounting concepts are assumptions, and generally we call it basic fundamentals within which the accounting operates. Or these accounting principles are rules, guidelines, and keeping in view the rules and guidelines, the business transactions are recorded in the books of the account and the financial statements are prepared. Then the second one is accounting convention. So accounting conventions are nothing, but these are the accounting practices. These are the outcomes of accounting principles. Say for example, as per the accounting standards which have been issued so far, when we talk about depreciation. So basically we charge the depreciation either on the straight line method or on the basis of diminishing balance method. So accounting standards provide that the firm must charge the depreciation on the fixed assets either on the straight line method or on the basis of written down value method. So here it depends upon the firm, it depends upon the nature of the firm, that which method the accounting firms generally adopt. Say for example, the business firm has decided to go for written down value method to charge the amount of depreciation on the fixed assets. So when the firm has decided to go for this particular method of charging depreciation, the firm remain consistent over a period of time, but it also does not mean that the firm cannot change its method of charging depreciation. Yes, of course, the firm can charge the depreciation even on the straight line basis, provided there must be some justified reason behind that. And if the result of changing the method of charging depreciation on the fixed assets provide a better result of providing accounting information, the firm can change the method of charging depreciation after a particular period. Features of accounting principles. The first one is flexible. So, well friends, as I have already discussed, that accounting principles, accounting standards, these are flexible in nature. This is the beauty of the accounting standards. These are not very much rigid in nature. So depending upon the circumstances, depending upon the business environment and law prevailing in the country, the accounting standards may get changed. Then accounting principles are man-made. So well learners, these accounting standards have been issued by a committee which comprises of many individuals. So these accounting standards are man-made. So as I have already discussed, that whenever the involvement of the individual takes place, there may be a chance of personal biasness. Then the third one is accounting principles are generally accepted. So the general acceptance of accounting principles depends upon the how the accounting principles serve the purpose of these three things. The first one is relevance. So the accounting standards may be relevant to the different users if they provide concrete informations to the various stakeholders who have vested their interests. So the relevance here means that they may be relevant to the individual only in a case where the financial statements or the accounting information can provide a concrete informations on the basis of which the individual can take a right decision at a right time. Then the third one is objectives. So the accounting standards are considered objective if they are free from the personal biasness. Because if any individual can influence the decisions, or if a particular person is in a position to influence the decision of a particular situation, so then these accounting informations may be of very less importance to the various stakeholders who have vested their interests. Then third one is feasible. It means these accounting standards and accounting principles can be easily understandable without any complexities and without any involving any sort of cost. So these may be a feasible that when accounting information, when accounting principles can easily be accessed by the individual without any complexities and without involving much cost. Because in case if accounting principles are of a nature where the individual is not in a position to understand the very purpose of recording the business transactions and the preparation of the financial statements, or it requires huge cost to understand the implications of the financial statements, then these accounting principles cannot be understood and cannot be regarded as feasible. Well, friends, now we will discuss the accounting concepts, or we can call it the accounting assumptions. First one is going concern. Well, friends, this going concern concept is very important, and it is quite obvious that whenever we start any business, we do not have any intention to close down or to, you know, wind up the business operation after a particular period, and we do not, you know, have any sort of intention to downsize or to, you know, scale down the business operation after a particular period. So according to the going concern concept, it is considered that the business will remain continue over a period of time, up to an indefinite period. That is why the accounting period concept has got much significance, because when we consider that the accounting or the business will remain continue up to an indefinite period, so when we do not divide the business into smaller segments, probably it will not be possible for the individual to determine or to measure the amount of profit or loss earned by the business. Then the second one is consistency. Well, friends, as we have already discussed, that any accounting policies once followed must be followed consistently over a period of time. Because when we follow such practices consistently over a period of time, it brings uniformity, and the financial statements probably provide a better picture about the profit and loss and about the financial position of that particular business. But again, we should be very clear that consistency does not mean that the accounting policies once followed by the firm must always be followed consistently and such practice cannot be changed. It's not like that, because as I have already discussed, that if the financial statements provide a better picture about the profitability and about the financial position, and if the preparation of the financial statements fail the change in accounting practices, or if we have a justified reason to change the method of charging depreciation, then yes, of course, by giving a justified note, we can change the method of charging depreciation from straight line method to written down value method, or vice versa. Then the third one is accrual concept. Well, friends, when we talk about accrual concept, it simply states that any business transaction is recorded in the books of the accounts when it is entered into. but not at the time when the business transactions are settled. Say for example, if a Ram and company is one firm, sold the good to Shyam and company worth rupees 5 lakh on 1st January 2019 for a period of 2 months. It means the Ram and company has sold the goods to Shyam and company on credit for a period of 2 months worth rupees 5 lakh. So here the business transaction has taken place on 1st of January 2019. Though the payment of this transaction, or you can say that this transactions will be settled after 2 months, that is on 1st April 2019. So here in this case, the transaction is recorded in the books of the account on 1st of January 2019 and the payment will be made after 2 months, that is on 1st of April 2019. So here in this case, the transactions has taken place on 1st of January 2019 irrespective of the amount received, because the amount will be received after 2 months. So here the accrual concept says that the accounting transactions will be considered on the date when it is entered into, rather not at the time when the accounting transactions are settled. Or you can say that Ram and company has decided to sold the goods to Shyam and company, say for example, after a period of 2 months. So Shyam and company provided advance of rupees 2 lakh on the same date for the sales which is to be made after 2 months. It means when the transaction has taken place on 1st of January 2019, that the sales will be made after 2 months, and for that sales the Shyam and company has provided advance of rupees 2 lakh to Ram and company on the first day when the transaction has taken place. So under such a situation, the payment which is given by Shyam and company to the Ram and company in advance for the sales which will take place after a period of 2 months. So here the transaction has taken place on 1st of April 2019, not on 1st January 2019, when simply the order has been given and the another firm has given rupees 2 lakh to the sellers in advance. So simply by giving the advance will not complete the transaction. The transactions will be completed, the transactions will take place only when the sales will be made, and this sales will take place only after 2 months. So here on 1st April 2019 the business transactions is recorded in the books of the account. Then business entity concept. So well friends, you might be well aware about business entity concept. So according to this concept, the existence, the entity of the proprietor and the entity of the business is considered separate. So my very sincere request to my learner is that they should not get any sort of confusion, because proprietor and business both are separate entity. Say for example, when the proprietor has started business investing rupees 5 lakh, so it means the proprietor has given rupees 5 lakh to the business as a loan. And of course, this amount of rupees 5 lakh will be repaid by the business to the proprietor in the time to come. So according to this concept, the accounting equation is considered as asset is equal to liabilities. So here in this case, when the proprietor has invested rupees 5 lakh for starting a business worth rupees 5 lakh. So here rupees 5 lakh is coming to the business. So the business will have an asset of rupees 5 lakh in the form of cash, and on the other hand, the business has a liability of rupees 5 lakh because the amount which the proprietor has invested into the business for starting a business, this amount will definitely be paid by the business to the proprietor in the time to come. And then further, if the business has borrowed a loan of rupees 2 lakh, then you now try to understand the implications of such transactions. So here, when the business has borrowed rupees 2 lakh from the bank, so here again we are getting rupees 2 lakh. So here our assets have been increased from rupees 5 lakh to 7 lakh. Earlier we had a cash balance of rupees 5 lakh and now we have borrowed a loan of rupees 2 lakh. So total assets the business is having now rupees 5 lakh plus 2 lakh, that is rupees 7 lakh assets, is equal to capital plus liabilities. So earlier we had a liabilities, that is we had capital of rupees 5 lakh plus liabilities because we have taken a loan of rupees 2 lakh from the bank. So therefore this is a liability for the business, and again this amount need to be repaid to the bank in the time to come. So here the accounting equation would be assets is equal to capital plus outside liabilities. So here assets are rupees 7 lakh, that is rupees 5 lakh as capital plus rupees 2 lakh, the amount which we have taken as a loan from the bank. So this amount of rupees 2 lakh in the form of cash. So total assets are here 7 lakh and liabilities plus capital. So here liability is rupees 2 lakh for the loan which we have taken from the bank plus 5 lakh as capital. So total 7 lakh is equal to 7 lakh. Our assets are rupees 7 lakh, our liabilities are rupees 7 lakh. Then accounting period concept. Well friends, the very purpose of the business is to earn profit. So in order to measure the accurate amount of profit earned by the business will be possible only when the losses and expenses of the business for a particular period are matched with the revenues and gains of that particular period of the business. Because if we simply take only expenses and losses, and if we do not consider the revenues and gains of that particular period of the business, probably we will not arrive at any conclusion, and vice versa also. So therefore, in order to measure the accurate amount of profit or loss, the accounting transactions which are taking place in the business over a period of time, this accounting period states that the life of the business must be divided into a smaller segments. As per the going concern concept, we have discussed that the business will remain continue up to an indefinite period. Yes, of course, but if this indefinite period is divided into a smaller segments. Generally, it is of 1 year. Then, yes, of course, after that particular segment, after that particular period of 1 year, if we match the expenses and losses of this particular period of the business to the revenues and gains of this particular period, say 1 year, we will definitely be in a position to measure, to identify the exact amount of profit or loss earned by the business. So, therefore, the accounting period must be divided into a smaller segments in order to see how business is running, how business is performing. So, we can only measure the performance of the business only when the life of the business is divided into a smaller segments. And after this regular interval, if we stop the activities of a business for a while, and if we match the expenses and losses of that particular period with the revenues and gain, then definitely we will be in a position to identify how much profit or loss the business has earned over a period of time. Then money measurement concept. Well, friends, as the name implies, that the business transactions which can be expressed in the monetary terms will only find a suitable place in the books of the accounts. Say, for example, building worth rupees 5 lakh, furniture worth rupees 2 lakh, plant and machine worth rupees 10 lakh. So, these things can easily be expressed in the monetary terms. So, therefore, such transactions can easily be recorded in the books of the account. But on the other hand, if I say that business has got a team of very honest and very dedicated staff, of course, it is a big asset to the firm. Since the monetary measurement is not possible, therefore, such event and transactions cannot be recorded in the books of the account. So, here this money measurement concept basically suffers from the two limitations. The first one is the value of the money is considered to be static here. And then the second one is non-cash items are not recorded. Then the third, next one is full disclosure. Well, friend, as in the beginning, I have made it very clear that in order to bring transparency, full disclosure of the accounting information is essential. So, any accounting information which is significant to the various stakeholders must be fully disclosed by the firm. Now, the question arises, which accounting information is significant and which accounting information is not significant. So, the significance of accounting information depends upon its nature and amount. If any accounting information which can influence the decision of the stakeholder is generally considered as significant information. So, this accounting concepts states that the accounting informations which are significant must be fully disclosed. No accounting information must be concealed, because if the accounting informations are not properly and fully disclosed, probably the various stakeholders who have vested their interest may not be in a position to take a right decision at right time. Then the materiality. Well, friends, it means that the transactions which are material in nature must be fully supported by the document, must be fully supported by the evidences, because there are numerous transactions taking place in the books of the accounts. And if we pay equal attention to all the business transaction, then it will not be possible for the accountant and for the firm to pay equal attention, and it is simply a waste of time, energy and resources of the firm. Therefore, the transactions which are material in nature, now again the question arises, what transaction is considered as material in nature? So again, friends, it is very, very simple that any transaction is considered as material in nature which can influence the decision of the stakeholders. So therefore, this transaction, say for example, here the materiality concepts when we talk about is very simple, that if the business has bought an asset worth rupees 2.5 lakh and the total assets of the firm is rupees 10 lakh, then of course these transactions may be material in nature, but the same transaction may not be material in nature for the other firm having an asset of rupees 15 crores. So this is again a subjective sort of things, that the transaction which is material in nature for one firm may and may not be material for the another firm. Then the conservatism concept or prudence concept, prudence. So well friends, according to this concept, it is considered that the business must always provide for the future losses, not for the future profits. So this has been made keeping in view the uncertainty that takes place in the business. So in order to make the financial position sound of the business, we generally feel that we must provide for the future losses. Therefore, keeping in view that we make provision for the depreciation, provision for bad and doubtful debts. Therefore, the conservatism concept states that we should not record any anticipated profit, because if we make provision for the anticipated profit and unfortunately such profit do not get turned in the time to come, it will put a question mark against the integrity of the financial statements, and the various stakeholders who have vested their interest, probably they will no more rely on such financial statements. Then the next one is cost concept. So well friends, according to the cost concept, the business, in business transaction, we must record the asset on the actual cost of the asset, or the price which we have paid to acquire the asset must be recorded in the books of the account irrespective of its market value. Say for example, on a particular date, if we have bought a machine of rupees 5 lakh, so we must record this business transaction in the books of account against rupees 5 lakh only, irrespective of the market value on that particular date, because the market value of that particular asset may be more than or even the less than that the actual amount which we have paid to acquire it. And of course, over a period of time, this asset will get automatically depreciated. So here, this amount of rupees 5 lakh which we have paid to acquire the asset will form the basis for the subsequent accounting period. Say for example, if we are charging depreciation at the rate of 10%, then in the end of the first year, we will show the asset in the asset side of the balance sheet against rupees 4,50,000. That is, after charging rupees 50,000 as depreciation, that is 10% of rupees 5 lakh. Then the matching concept, well friends, as I have already mentioned, that in order to determine the accurate amount of profit earned by the business, the expenses and losses of a particular period must be matched with the revenue and gains of that particular period. Only then we will be in a position to determine the accurate amount of profit earned by a business firm. So here the amount received or the amount paid by the business does not matter at all. Very simple, say for example, if you have taken a loan of rupees 5 lakh on 1st of June 2019 and you are preparing the financial statements from 1st of April 2019 to 31st March 2020. So here you have taken a loan of rupees 5 lakh at the rate of 10%, say for on 1st July. So it means April, May and June, 3 months have gone, and on 1st July you have taken a loan of rupees 5 lakh at the rate of 10%. So the 10% of rupees 5 lakh is 50,000 for the complete year. But here, because you have taken a loan of rupees 5 lakh at the rate of 10% on 1st July, so here you have earned the, if you have, you know, the interest on such loan is 10% on rupees 5 lakh for a period of 9 months. So here this is the expenses for the business, interest for a period of 9 months, irrespective whether the amount of such interest has been paid by the business by 31st of March 2020 or not. So here the payment received or payment made does not affect the significance of the transactions. Rather, when any transaction is entered into the business, it must be recorded as an expenses or vice versa as the case may be. Then dual aspect. Well friends, this is the last concept which we are going to discuss, that as per this concept, in accounting every business transaction has dual aspect. Well friends, as we have discussed, one business transaction, that say for example, if the proprietor has invested rupees 5 lakh in a business for starting its business. So as per the dual aspect, if one aspect of the business is going to be debited, another aspect will automatically be credited by the equal amount. So for this business transaction, we record this business transaction in the primary books of the accounts, that cash account debit to capital. So here cash is coming to the business because cash is an asset for the business, and as per the real account, because all the assets comes under real account, debit what comes in and credit what goes out. So here the cash is coming, therefore cash must be debited. And capital, so here this capital is representing the account of someone who has invested rupees 5 lakh into the business. So here the proprietor accounts is going to be credited. So the account of capital is basically a personal account, and as per the rationale of the personal account, debit the receiver and credit the giver. So here it is the proprietor who is giving the funds to the business, therefore his account must be credited. So here 5 lakh has been debited and the same amount has been credited. So as per this concept, the one aspect of the business transaction is going to be debited, other aspect will automatically be credited by the equal amount. So this was all for the today's lecture in accounting standards and principles. So well friends, keep in touch in the future also. So we will keep meeting in the time to come with different topics. So I am sure that today the transactions or the discussions which we have made will definitely resolve the doubt of the learners, and I am sure that in the time to come, whatever topics we'll be discussing in the time to come,